Welcome, family, to another episode of God's Glory and His Story. I am your host, MC Enemy, but as always, it's not about me. It's about the Word of God and His truth on this channel. Welcome to Fellowship. This episode is scheduled to be aired Friday, December 15th, 2023. Yah is looking for people to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And on this channel, we focus on His truth and we let His truth set you free. And to those who say it doesn't matter what Christ looks like, and there's many other applications to this scripture, but I got a scripture for you. You want to hear it? Here you go. 1611 King James Bible, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10 through 12. It is written, "And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, Yah shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." Don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with an understanding of God's word and His love for you. If you haven't done so yet, or you're new to the channel, we ask that you download at least two Bible apps. And we want you to make one of those Bible apps the 1611 King James Bible with the Apocrypha. There are additional books in there that you cannot get in the standard 66 book version. And you wouldn't go out there and buy a book knowing that you're missing pages and chapters now, would you? And the reason why we say at least two downloads right in the middle of your screen, the facts of every case must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, but more importantly to me is that you share this episode with others. You never know who you may be putting on a path to Christ. In case you missed it last week, episode 183, called Cold Blooded. Discover the power of the blood of the Messiah. We implore you not to have a form of godliness, but still deny the power thereof. Go check it out. It will bless you. Today's episode, episode 184. You will never view Christmas the same. And as an honorable mention, you can go back because there's some historical stuff that I've gone over back in episode 133, where I said Christmas is not noble, is noble, but it's not biblical. You can go back and check that out also for some background. Now, before we get started with today, I want to remind you that while Christmas is not a day of Yah, we are also reminded in the scriptures not to forget assembling ourselves together. You know, very rarely do families get together nowadays, except for holidays and weddings and funerals. So I don't think you should miss out on the opportunity to fellowship with your family. And also, it's a great day to share the gospel. The true reason for why we're here, period. They say the reason for the season, but knowing the episode that we're about to present, I'm kind of trying to find the right words to put forth. But with that being said, let's get to work. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 34, verse 12 through 14. It is written, "Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. For thou shalt worship no other god. For Yah, whose name is jealous, is a jealous Elohim," what jealous God. 1611 King James Bible, Isaiah chapter 42, verse 8. It is written, "I am Yah, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images." So we're going to build from those two scriptures, and we're going to deconstruct this holiday that they call Christmas. So on the left in the margin, you see we got some facts about Christmas. I'm not going to read that, but I'm going to get into the scriptures that it does talk about in here. So the first scripture they bring up is Ezekiel chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. It is written, "And it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in my house, the elders of Judah sat before me, that the hand of Yah fell there upon me. Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his loins even downward, fire. And from his loins even upward, as the appearance of brightness, as the color of amber. And he put forth the form of a hand, and took me by a lock of mine head. And the Spirit lifted me up between the earth and the heaven, and brought me in the visions of Yah to Jerusalem, to the door of the inner gate that looketh toward the north, where he was the seat of the image of jealousy, which provoketh to jealousy. And behold, the glory of Yah of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in the plain." So take note of what I have highlighted there. I got the sixth year and the sixth month. And he also, the fact that he said he took him by a lock of his hair. Here. Well, what is the origin of the lock of hair? Just out of curiosity, it drew my attention. And it says, according to Dr. DeLongoria, braided and locked hair was worn by people in the Sahara Desert since 3000 BC. dreadlocks was also worn by followers of Abrahamic religions. For example, the Ethiopian Coptic priests adopted dreadlocks as a hairstyle before the 5th century AD. So could the locks that he grabbed him by, he said the lock of hair that he grabbed him by, could it have been a dreadlock? Or could it just been what we consider to be a grouping of hair? It said lock. Another indication that the Israelites were and are swarthy people. The next scripture that it mentions from the margin is still in Ezekiel chapter 8, but now it's verses 14 through 17. And here's where it gets good, because it's continuing on. It is written, "Then he brought me to the door of the gate of Yah's house, which was toward the north. And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Then he said unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of Yah's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of Yah, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of Yah and their faces toward the east. And they worshiped the sun towards the east. Then he said unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence and have returned to provoke me to anger. And lo, they put the branch to their nose." So here we got women crying for Tammuz. Now, normally when you're crying for somebody, you're mourning somebody's death, right? So I guess they were mourning the pagan god Tammuz, who was the son, supposed to be the son of Nimrod and Semiramis. So they're crying at the gate of his temple and worshiping the sun, the S-U-N, at his temple door. And Yah says these are abominations. These are things he hates. He tells Ezekiel, can you believe this? Does Israel think this is a joke? They are pissing me off right now. That's what he's saying in today's language. So let's go back to that. It said the 6th month. Well, here the first scripture in Exodus chapter 12, verse 1 through 3. It is written, "And Yah spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel in the 10th day of this month, that they should take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house." So this is going to be the Passover. So that's the March-April period. The March into April period. In Hebrew, it says it's the month of Nisan. I believe there's another name for it. I think it might have been called the month of Abib. Don't quote me on that. But that would be month number one, because they didn't have all those the pagan names for the months and the pagan days of the week. So if the March-April new moon is month number one, you can see month number six would be the August-September time period. So they were worshiping the sun and mourning Tammuz in August-September. Though the book itself indicates that the prophecies of Ezekiel occurred from about 593 to 571 BC, some scholars have argued that the book was written during a widely divergent period. But we're going to just use that 593 to 571 BCE just to give you a time period of when Ezekiel was writing his scriptures. Still have the column on the left. You can read that at your leisure, but I'm just going through some of the, picking out some of these scriptures. And the next scripture that is picking out is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26. It is written, "For I have received of the Lord, or of Yah, that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord, or the King Jesus, or King Yeshua, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Let me say that one more time for the people in the back. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, he also took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the King's death till he come." So we are told to commemorate his death, not his birth. That's why it never told us when his birth was. But why was it important to commemorate his death? Because if you have a will cannot be enforced until the subject of that will has passed away. Moving on, still got the column on the left. And we're going to look at the next scripture, Jeremiah chapter 10, verses 1 through 5. It is written, "Hear ye the word of Yah speaketh unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith Yah, learn not the ways of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them. For the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen, with the axe. They deck it with silver and gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. They are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They must needs be born, because they cannot go. Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil. Neither also is it in them to do good." So most people think that sounds like he's cutting down of the forest a Christmas tree. But in fact, I believe what they were actually doing is they were in fact cutting a tree out of the forest. But what they were doing is they were making idols out of it. They were carving it up to make idols, and they were hanging like earrings and tinsel and gold and stuff on the idol. So they were basically creating their own idol. Now, just like Messiah said to eat his body symbolically, the tree or the idol that was made from it represents the body of Nimrod. And the last scripture from the column on the right, excuse me, on the left, is 1611 King James Bible, Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. It is written, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of Yah shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Messiah, the King. So why do I have that first sentence there, the first scripture, verse number 8, highlighted? Because shepherds don't herd their flocks in the winter. Why? Because there's no grass. There's no grass for the flock to feed off of. So the Feast of Dedication, also known as the Festival of Lights. We kind of touched on this last week, I believe. So Hanukkah started in 165 BC on the 25th day of the Hebrew month called Kislev. And it was the Feast of Dedication because it celebrated the Maccabees' victory over the Greek oppression. And they were rededicating the temple. Now, why did it become also known as the Festival of Lights? Because the menorah, they only had enough oil to last them for one day, and that oil lasted for 8 days. That's why it is an 8-day celebration, which actually ends on sundown on the 14th. So by the time you guys get this on the 15th, the Festival of Lights or Hanukkah or the Feast of Dedication will be over. Again, it's not a feast day given by Yah. However, we did talk about it last week, and Messiah did observe that festival. So how did December 25th become Christmas? Under Emperor Constantine, the church in Rome began celebrating Christmas on December 25th in 336. Some say the date was chosen to outshine Sol Invictus and pagan celebrations, but there is much doubt around whether Christians had been trying to steal Sol Invictus's thunder. So it goes on to talk about the Maccabees and how it came about and what they were fighting. So you can pause the video, take a screenshot, blow these up and read these for your own edification. We also have some more scriptures here, another screenshot you should be taking at this time. So you can read these at your own pace. So from the Feast of Dedication, also known as the Festival of Lights, we get the festive lights that we have during this season. And then the 25th day of Kislev, they just morphed it into the 25th day of December. So the Festival of Lights meets Sol Invictus. They merge. And now we get the rebirth of Tammuz worship, now known as Sol Invictus. So is Sol Invictus a pagan holiday? The Emperor Aurelian revived his cult in 274 AD and promoted Sol Invictus as the chief god of the empire. The main festival dedicated to him was the Dies Natalis Solis Invicti, birthday of the invincible sun, on the 25th of December. So this is prior to the official first Christmas. So when was the first Christmas celebration? It wasn't until 336 AD. So Sol Invictus now meets Center Claus. Also known as St. Nicholas Day. It's observed on the 5th or 6th of December in Western Christian countries and on the 19th of December in Eastern Christian countries using the old church calendar. It's the feast day of St. Nicholas of Myra. It falls within the season of Advent. It is celebrated as a Christian festival with particular regard to St. Nicholas reputation as a bringer of gifts, as well as through the attendance of church services. That's where we get Christ and Mass, because Catholics go to Mass. The American Santa Claus, as well as the British Father Christmas, derived from St. Nicholas, Santa Claus. If you shift those letters around in Santa, I think you're going to find another word shows up. Santa Claus is itself derived in part from the Dutch Sinterklaas, the saint's name in that language. How ironic. But anyway, I digress. However, the gift of giving associated with these descendant figures is associated with Christmas Day rather than St. Nicholas itself. So now, Nicholas was officially recognized as a saint in the 800s, and in the 1200s, Catholics in France began celebrating Bishop Nicholas's Day on December 6th. So in the 1200s, when it became a big thing, and they removed the focus from Messiah's birth. Everybody's focusing on the giving of gifts. Sixteen 11 King James Bible, Matthew chapter 2, verses 9 through 11, it is written. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So that's where Santa Claus or Santa Claus or Saint Nicholas, that's where his legend came from. But as we said before, Yah said, my glory will I not give to another. Another way of saying that is, I'm not sharing my spotlight. And we read that verse in the beginning, you know, in Isaiah 42, verse 8. We read that earlier. But now listen to what Yah says in Amos. 1611 King James Bible, Amos chapter 5, verse 21 through 27. It is written, I hate, I despise your feast days. And I will not smell in your solemn assemblies. Though ye offer me burnt offerings and your meat offerings, I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beast. Take thou away from me the noise of thy songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vials. But let judgment run down as water, and righteousness as mighty as stream. Have ye offered unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Molech, and Chium, your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves. Therefore, I will cause you to go into captivity beyond Damascus, saith Yah, whose name is the God of hosts, or Yah of hosts. So he was speaking to the children of Israel, that he despises their feasts and won't accept their offerings because they were doing the same thing to their man-made gods. It's like, how dare you? You know who I am? You guys know who I am. Out of all the other people in this world, he told them, that, out of all the families on the earth, you have I made myself known to. So he wasn't having it. So Molech and Chium. So the star of Chium is also known as the star of Remphan. Look familiar? 6 points, six sides, six triangles. That symbol has nothing to do with King David. I did an episode on this also, way back when. So the people occupying the land that fly that emblem, they are converts to Judaism called Khazars. So who are the Khazars? They are a Turkic people. And in the late 6th century AD, they established a major commercial empire covering the southeast section of modern-day European Russia, southern Ukraine, Crimea, and Kazakhstan. So here is a picture of those areas on the left, bottom left. So the Khazars initially made their wealth by controlling what they called the Silk Road, which was the main pathway to Asia from Europe for trading goods. So anybody who wanted to pass by had to pay the fare. So if you look at the symbols, look at the Ukraine crest, the yellow and blue. And then if you look at the other arrow, and it shows you the Khazarian Tamga. It's a design identifying property or cattle belonging to a specific Turkic clan, usually as a cattle brand or a stamp. So Khazarian Tamga, the Ukrainian crest, they look exactly the same. So the Ukraine crest is the Khazarian Tamga, but the Khazarian Tamga is the Molech Sigil. Look at the center column. So there's that name again, Molech, a pagan god of the Ammonites and I forget which other ites. Oh, Molech, Ammonites and Phoenicians. I believe there's another one also, but I can't think of it off the top of my head. But that's a pagan god. And if you look at the bottom right of your screen, you can see what the sigil of Molech is, or what it looks like. And it says it's a satanic seal. So if the Ukraine crest and the Khazarian Tamga are images of this satanic seal, And if you don't believe that that is a Ukraine symbol, let's look at this picture. This guy should look familiar. You can see it's right there on his sweatshirt on the right. And they have he has a golden colored crest behind him on the official website. Do what you will with that information. 1611 King James Bible, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 1 through 4. It is written, "And Yah spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them concerning the feast of Yah, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations." So you're going to get together and have church when my feast days. "Even these are my feast days. 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath day of rest and holy convocation. Ye shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of Yah in all your dwellings. These are the feasts of Yah, even holy convocations, which ye shall proclaim in their seasons." So you can go on and read that Leviticus 23, and you will have all of the ordained feast days of Yah. But now here's the kicker. After you got all those feast days, which is part of his law, statutes, and commandments, 1611 King James Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, it is written, "Now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments which I teach you for to do them, that ye may live, and go in and possess the land which Yah of your fathers giveth you. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish out from it, that ye may keep the commandments of Yah, your God, which I command you." Not supposed to add, not supposed to take away. All right, I'll leave you with this scripture, 1611 King James Bible, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, and then verses 28 through 31. It is written, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall be thought worthy who hath trodden under the foot of the Son of Yah, and hath counted the blood of the covenant, where with he was sanctified an unholy thing, and have done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that hath said, Vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith Yah. And again, the king shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." So family, you've already been forgiven. All you need to do is ABC. Accept the Messiah as your personal Savior. Believe he died for your sins and confess it with your mouth. Messiah said it best in Matthew chapter 12, verse 34, and I'm paraphrasing, but if you believe something in your heart, you'll have no problem speaking it. So get in where you fit in. Tomorrow is not promised. Pause the video and recite this simple prayer. If you have recited this prayer with sincerity and repentance in your heart, let me be the first to welcome you to the family. Now, if you accept the Messiah today, please just drop us a comment line in the comments that simply states, "I'm in." That way we can all celebrate with the angels for your arrival. But on this channel, we don't make orphans. It's a three-step process to continue your walk. Step number one is to read your Bible daily. People say it's difficult. I got you covered. Episode 62 on this channel, How to Read the Bible, will guide you. Step number two is to find a Bible-based place that you can grow. This has to be a place that is not stuck in the doctrines of men, meaning that everything that they do needs to be supported by the word of Yah. And step number three is to pray without ceasing. Bring all your cares and concerns and lay them at the foot of the Most High Yah. And when you've done all those three things, you rinse and repeat. All right, so the various channels that you can check me out on. Don't forget, like, comment, subscribe. Again, more importantly to me is to share it with others. Thank you, family, for allowing me to grow in this knowledge. And in turn, I pray you grow in faith. Thank you guys for watching. I love you guys. As always, worship the Father, praise the Son, and accept the Holy Spirit. May our Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.
Is the